I want to welcome everybody here to the first kind of event of this kind. The library has been doing Open Access Week for a few years now. We've just added on to it a little bit, and I'll talk a little bit about that in a moment. My name is Wayne Smith. I'm from the Department of Management. This is Elizabeth Altman to my right, to your left, from the University of the from the University Library. And we have been working with our colleagues on this list for about 6 months, putting this whole day together in a wide variety of areas. We're not the most important people. The most important people are the speakers, the plenary speakers, and the faculty speakers today. But these people have been working diligently on this task for quite some time. Would you join me in giving them a hand for this? There's a morning session, lunch, and afternoon session. This is not a very good list, actually. Sorry, it's just me whipping some ideas together. Our main idea is to have a nice keynote from Professor Rob Gould here at UCLA, talking a little bit about modern data science, among other things, and then some faculty talks from several different departments. If we have time, also, we have a couple of students here, including a student, Saeed, over here. Saeed, raise your hand, that Professor Bruce Shapiro and I helped place. He did a data science internship at Electronic Arts, and so if we have time, we should be able to hear a little bit from him. And the Associate Vice President for Research, Chris Kazakian, I can never pronounce his last name correctly, should be here later on to talk a little bit about some ideas that he has for working on data-oriented problems here on campus. And that's our general outline. As I mentioned before, the library has been developing programs aligned with Open Access Week for a few years now. The word open has multiple meanings to multiple people. Even if you use it as a compound noun, open access or open data, you still end up with multiple meanings. So the afternoon session will be more related to openness, related to repositories, publishing, metadata, and related activities. The morning session will be a little bit more technical. That's the piece we added, or maybe a little more technological or quantitative, on open big data sets, data science, and open tools needed for reproducibility, and all the many of the other meanings of open that you might associate with in your head. We couldn't figure out how to cram all of that in 1 hour or 2 hours. But we also didn't want to shy away from difficult issues that affect our teaching, research, service, and consulting activities. Shying away from a difficult topic doesn't help us. So we thought we'd add a few hours to the list, and that's how we got this particular day. So again, I thank you for coming. The genesis for this day was in the Provost ACAT Committee, which is short for the Advisory Committee on Academic Technology. It was a couple of conversations about what we can do on campus, and it enjoyed the early support from our Provost. Our Provost is here with us today, Provost Yi Lee.
Well, thank you very much. Just before coming here, I did a little bit of internet search. So got some statistics about internet access. In terms of internet users, it has risen from year 2000 to 738 million by the end of 2015, 3.2 billion users. So in terms of total population of the world, it raised from 7% to 43% as of last year. And during this time, since 2007, the mobile users has increased 12-fold from 2007. Right now, by the end of 2015, about 69-70% of the world populations are covered by 3G mobiles. Actually, on the screen, as I was checking at, the the number changes every second. I was able to track down at a particular number as I was jotting down the numbers, 1,098,227,530 websites at that time. Okay. This kind of connectivity is really present tremendous opportunities for us, for the humankind, and especially for higher education, but also provides tremendous challenges for us. We might have imagined that early on, this kind of connectivity, easy of publication, might actually drive down the cost of our library, or for example, subscription. Well, Martin Stover will tell you otherwise. Okay. There's still a 250,000 budget request on my desk. I need to find money to pay for. But that's the challenge. You know, we as faculty, especially in the intellectual communities, faculty, students, graduate students, and graduate students, we put together, you know, all these fundings and activities, produce the intellectual property, and at the end, at least me as one member gave up all that right very easily and a long time ago. Okay, so that's one challenge we have. How we actually continue to encourage and promote that intellectual exchange without hurting the publishers. You know, we don't want them to disappear or go bankrupt, but also really help us to sustain, okay, what we need. So that's, you know, open access. That's a big deal. That's a tremendous deal. I remember when I began as a faculty member, later in my career, you know, start at Iowa, every library committee, departmental library committee, college library committee, university library committee, one of the most difficult tasks is every few years, we had to go through the list at the departmental college or the university level to strike down the publications where we deem or forced to be the least needed. Of course, publishers, they're smart. They began to bundle their publications together. Okay, making my job at that time so much easier later on. Because you really cannot do anything with it. Okay, so I think it is a tremendous challenge, and that's one of the difficult things. I'm also guilty of that. I continue to publish and publish in these traditional journals. So far, I only have one publication in open access, plus one. So I'm partially responsible for that and how we change that as we go on. So that this kind of a dialogue and information exchange, I have found that to be very helpful to get us informed, especially for junior faculty. The other part is really, if you think about that, over 1 billion websites, you know, 3 billion users, multiple users from access, you know, multiple websites, the kind of combination, kind of result, the time series, all that provide a tremendous amount of data for us. But also, it's extremely challenging because this is such a human, you know, hard dimension. 1 billion websites multiplied by 3 billion human beings. Okay. So it's just appalling, the challenge. And how do we actually get things out of this? To find the patterns, to search for certain truths, to really navigate that. That's really very interesting. Okay. Think about the things that in such a higher dimension, you're trying to look for patterns. You have no way to visualize that. If you look at the 3D, I think human intuition is very strong. We can look at that to say, yeah, there is a pattern. But such high dimension, it's interesting. So I think, you know, I really appreciate this. But also, it is necessary. It's not just the internet. The kind of information we collect from biology, for example, or genome series. How do you make anything out of that? How do you find the pattern? Suppose you collect all the, well, not collect, you get the data or genomes from all the patients that have certain kind of cancer. You're sure you have information there. You do the genome research, you do the sequencing. What are you looking for? Because there are just so many different segmentations. How do you actually find the one and confirm? So I think this is interesting. We have at our fingertips the informations and the tools. Our scientists, well, including policymakers, are really just to make sense out of that. Find the patterns, identify the patterns, and then trying to make the best use of that. You know, I really hope you have a invigorating exchange today, and I want to thank Robert. I look up your CV before I came, and I also look at the MassSci Network. I found one publication from you in the mass world. I'm your statistician, so that's about curriculum of statistics. But anyway, I'm really impressed by your work, your publications about policies and data science. So, well, thank you very much. Thank the faculty, student here. Thank the four deans who co-sponsored this, Wayne and Elizabeth for organizing this. I'm looking forward to hear great news and maybe report at the next ACAD meeting. Yes. Yeah, thank you very much.
I'll introduce you.
Okay.
I just wanted to thank all the deans. As soon as the idea for a data science or a big data addition to the existing library work was discussed, when it was just an idea between a couple of people, a couple of deans stepped up and said, "We're already here. We should be doing this now. This is exactly the right thing to do." So these four deans funded particular this day, but also gave us guidance on what we should be thinking about, who we should be connecting with. Dean Ramesh did yeoman work with me on that particular issue. Dean Stover said yes when it was just a weird idea. And Dean Mike Spagna of the College of Education was really one of the main people behind this also, that said everybody needs to be doing this and we need to be doing this right now. And so, and Dean Theodulu also indicated that this is important, even though she's in the College of Social and Behavioral Sciences, she knows that we're partnering with public agencies and these kinds of open access, open tools, open repositories affects the entire college, the entire university, not just the traditional STEM disciplines. Here to talk to us a little bit is, as a representative of the deans, is our host dean, Mark Stover.
Thank you, Wayne.
Thanks.
Well, thank you all for coming today, or in other words, welcome to my humble abode. It's great to have this wonderful room here in the library, the center of campus, where we can hold so many events. And it does seem especially appropriate to hold an open access, open data event here because of the cross-disciplinary nature of what we're going to be talking about today. A lot of it's going to focus on science, but it also goes into many other disciplines as well. I just want to say a couple words about the history of open access, open data at Cal State Northridge. In 2003, our president, Diane Harrison, was the very first California State University president to sign the Berlin Declaration on Open Access to Knowledge in the Sciences and Humanities. And then later that same year, the Faculty Senate here at Cal State Northridge became the very first Senate in the CSU to sponsor an open access resolution. So you don't always have that kind of congruity between administration and the Faculty Senate. But this campus has always been known for its, or I shouldn't say always, but for the last 15 or 20 years, been known for its collegiality in that area. And open access was something that was especially easy, I think, for the administration and the faculty to both get on board with. So we're all very proud of our leadership in the realm of open access, open data. And today's colloquium is just one more example of that leadership. So you saw the list of the planning committee members who worked very hard to make this event happen today. I just want to give a special shout out to the co-directors of the planning committee, right over here, Elizabeth Altman and Wayne Smith. They both have worked extremely hard as Wayne said earlier, over the last 6 months to make this event happen. And I think that you'll all be pleased by the results. I want to say a little bit about Wayne, if you don't mind. Just a little bit. Wayne had the foresight to see that open data is really crucial and critical to the future of science and scholarship. And he had the energy to find the right people to bring together, to talk to discuss, to put on the planning committee, to work with, to push things forward. And finally, he had the charisma and the persistence and, dare I say it, the chutzpah to get co-sponsorships.
That's probably more like it.
Yeah. To get co-sponsorships, which means money, from four different deans. Not an easy task. So thank you, Wayne, for being, and Elizabeth too, for both of you being the driving force behind today's events. And speaking of Wayne, I'm going to ask him to come back up to the podium to introduce our keynote speaker for today.
That's the first and last time anyone will ever use the term charisma and Wayne Smith in the same sentence. So I'm glad we have that on tape and that'll go viral eventually. Our morning plenary and our keynote speaker is Professor Rob Gould from UCLA. He has the usual credits that you would expect, high-end institution, good work. He's actually, you and I were chatting on the way in. I'm a local boy. I'm a local boy. I grew up in Southern California. He also grew up in Southern California. It's not something I knew. I did my PhD work at Claremont Graduate University. He went to Harvey Mudd. But he grew up here locally as well. He's in charge of all the undergraduate programs in STAT at UCLA. But the real reason we invited him is all of his extra work in the community. He's not just involved with academics, he's involved in professional meetings. He and I bumped into each other at Google 5 months ago, and I don't know if you're gonna be at the Red Bull event on Thursday. I help coordinate some of the professional activities in Silicon Beach on the other side. Rob is also not just involved in his own undergraduates, but involved in undergraduates across the entire Southern California area. He'll talk a little bit about that also. And then, maybe most interestingly, he didn't stop there, as if that's enough of a career. He took on thinking about what the future might look like in mathematical education, STAT education, and a variety of related topics with our K-12 partners, including LAUSD, and more than just writing a paper about it, he actually worked on a major pilot project on that. So I think those issues touch upon very important ideas at our campus, and Rob has a lot to say about data science and a lot to say about all those other topics as well. And I thought, I as well as the program committee thought that he might be the best person to lead off our colloquium today. So please help me give a warm CSUN welcome to Professor Rob Gould from UCLA.
Okay. Wayne has been one of the major advocates for data and data education in the greater LA area, so it's an honor to be invited by him. Thank you. So I'm going to talk about four things, each of which I've talked before for about an hour. And Wayne tells me I have only 2.5 hours. So I'm going to go a little fast.
But they know where to find you.
Yeah, it'll only feel like 2.5 hours, I promise. So I'm involved mostly in my career area is statistics education. And my training is as a statistician, and I'm in a statistics department. So those are my biases that I just want to lay out on the table, and that will become very apparent. And primarily what I want to talk to is about three educational initiatives that I think you'd find interesting that address this broad area of data science. But before we do that, I want to talk about what is data science. As Wayne said, you know, open data means a lot of different things to a lot of people, and data science means maybe even more things to fewer people, if that makes any sense. I have kind of two premises, and again, my view of data science is a statistician's view, and even more as a statistics educator's view, which is a little different. But basically, I think I want to show you some examples that I think will convince you that data science, from the statistics point of view, arose out of a reaction against statistics, with the sense that statistics, or the perception that it was too narrow of a field and wasn't reacting to changes in the world. But I also think it's become more than that, a culture. And maybe the real differences about data science are cultural than scientific. So the outline I'm about to give you, by the way, comes from a paper I'm going to mention inside in a moment by David Donahoe, so a statistician at Stanford, who has a wonderful paper that's just coming out about, it's called 50 Years of Data Science. And so I've kind of borrowed his history more or less. But the story more or less begins with John Tukey, who maybe is the father of data analysis as a field. And in 1962, he's complaining that statistics is too focused on mathematical theory, not focused enough on data analysis. He feels separated from statistics because he's so interested in data analysis. So therefore, he redefined data analysis to include statistics. So he kind of expanded the data analysis bubble to include some statistics. But I think he kind of identified a certain dichotomy or a conflict between two branches of statistics, the data analytic branch and the mathematical branch. Another interesting thing I want to spend a little more time on, in 2001, Leo Bryman, statistician at Berkeley, who's since passed away, wrote a really kind of groundbreaking paper, but lots of people have paid attention to, Statistical Modeling the Two Cultures. He claimed that there were two different ways of creating models in statistics. The predominant culture was what he called data modeling, which has later been more easily called the inference culture. So this is the culture that if any of you ever took a statistics class, you grew up in. The idea here is that the goal of statistics is to develop models that tell us something about the real world. And when we do inference, we use those models to understand the larger world, and so our interest is in what the model tells us about certain variables. You know, does a variable belong in the model or not? If it doesn't, that means that variable doesn't play a role in the real model. But the key idea here is always that your model needs to look something like nature. Bryman argued that this approach was extremely limiting, was preventing statistics from dealing with very important and innovative problems. And he contrasted this with what he called the algorithmic modeling culture, which especially if you're given a talk is very, very hard to say. So David Donahoe again renamed this the prediction culture. In the prediction culture, your model is a black box. You don't care whether it looks like nature or not. You only care if its output matches nature's output. So it's about making predictions about the future regardless of what comes inside. I was just reading an article in the New Yorker just last night. Doesn't really matter too much what it's about, but it's about the startup culture in Silicon Valley, and maybe some of you saw it, about someone else whose last name is Altman. I can't remember his first name. But he talked about his his what do they call it, incubator company takes applicants, and they have a neural network algorithm that tries to predict which applicants will be successful. And the journalists ask him, how does that network work? And he says, who knows? We don't know what happens inside. It spits out predictions of who's going to be successful, and it seems to be right. And that's the algorithmic modeling culture. So that's another dichotomy we have between inference and prediction. Just really quickly, Bill Cleveland is another statistician who again complained that statistics wasn't a wide enough area. He said that a statistics department should be doing these activities and these percentages, but most of the departments he knew of spent about 100% of their time in theory, and therefore he felt this was, even though if you read all the literature of what statisticians say they do, mostly this is what was actually happening, and therefore we should recall this area data science if it looked like this. I'm going to say I don't agree with all these. I'm just kind of laying out what the view looks like from a statistics point of view. So David Donahoe, I mentioned earlier, his new paper was given at the Tukey 100th Centennial Address. He said that he thinks, for the most part, data science, the talk is hype. And that's my word, not his. He says that a lot of the motivation for data science has come from kind of temporary cultural and technological aberrations, if you will. So, for example, a common thing you hear is that we need data science because of big data. Well, he points out data has always been big. If you define data as bigger than it can fit on your laptop, well, there used to be no laptops, so all data used to be big. And now you can always solve that problem by waiting a year, and what was big a year ago is no longer big now because of memory and hardware and all this sort of stuff. So big data is in itself really the motivation. But what he thinks is there really is a notion there that there's a true science lurking in the background if we define it to be learning from data with all that entails. And it's that last part that's really interesting, because I think as a statistician, I've always thought of statistics as the science of learning from data. But in truth, we often put lots of preconditions on that data. It needs to come from a random sample. It needs to be in a spreadsheet. It needs, and this is telling us that you have to get rid of all that. We have to study the data as it comes to us and get our learning from it in whatever form it arrives. One last thing I want to point your attention to, Stephen Stigler is a statistician at the University of Chicago who is also a historian. I believe it's that way, but he might also be a historian who's also a statistician. And he has a wonderful book out now called The Seven Pillars of Statistical Wisdom. The seven pillars are each the major central themes of statistics. He traces these back over the last 200 years and shows the problems that these pillars have allowed us to solve. In his final chapter, he never talks about data analysis, but he points out that the pillars, there are some interesting problems facing us now that the pillars don't support or don't entirely support. The first, and I'm going to kind of go over this quickly, is the formulation of predictions and classifiers in big data, meaning it's the curse of dimensionality. When you have many, many variables, it means your data set, if you're trying to put things into categories, some categories will be very, very sparse. It's a very challenging problem. Large multiple comparison problems. So our provost just talked about the genetics, and I overheard people talking about this notion of having, you know, in genetics they often do hundreds if not thousands of simultaneous hypothesis tests. The mechanisms aren't quite supported, still quite support that. And this last one is really interesting to what I'm about to talk about. Analyses where the focused questions follow as a final stage of scientific study, and a study that's at least part exploratory. So in other words, this has turned on its head. In the good old-fashioned scientific statistical viewpoint of the world, first comes the theory, then comes questions, then comes the design of experiment, and then comes an answer. And this is talking about the many, many studies that go the other way. First comes the data, then comes what's the story the data are trying to tell us. And maybe from that come experiments. And our seven pillars of wisdom don't quite support this. But this is really, I think, in education land where a lot of the excitement and interest is. So So with that kind of as a background, just a quick overview of how I see the difference between statistics and data science. So as Leo Bryman says, statistics leans on the side of inference, data science leans on the side of prediction. Statistics leans on the side of mathematics, data science on the side of data analysis. And now another thing I want to talk about, which is going to play a big role in some, I think, in a lot of our future educational initiatives, is there's a real cultural difference in the way these two fields work. So the paradigm for statistics is that the statistician works as a collaborator in a research team, or as a consultant who they call up and say, we've got this problem with data analysis, can you help us? Yes, I'll help you on the problem, then he solves it and leaves. Data science seems to be working under a much more entrepreneurial sort of spirit. And I've kind of called this competitive cooperation. And it ties in really well with the open data sort of mindset. And it ties in really well with the Silicon Valley entrepreneurial mindset. I first kind of noticed this once. I host an annual seminar for undergraduates called Careers in Statistics. And I get data professionals to come in and say, what do you do and how did you get here? And one year I had Yasmin Lucero, who's very active in the local data science world. And she talked about how she got her job. And it wasn't just that she had a resume and she sent it to places. She joined competitions, and one or two of them I think she won, but she published the results on LinkedIn and on her blog and created a portfolio, and that portfolio caught the attention of several employers who hired her. So it was a really different way of thinking about your career and getting a job than we were used to. And I want to say just a little bit more about that. So David Donahoe in his paper points out that there's kind of a name for this thing, the Common Task Framework. It's not a very exciting name, but he coined a better one as he's done throughout this whole paper. He calls this the secret sauce to the success of the predictive modeling world. So the secret sauce is this. Three ingredients. First, there's a publicly available training data set. So it's open data. Everyone has access to this data set. Next, there's a group of competitors who share a goal. They're cooperating around the notion that they're going to try to make predictions from this data set about what will be seen in a future revealed data set. So, finally, there's a referee who decides what it means to say that your predictions are close to the future data. And so this referee determines the winner. What's missing from this list is there's an iterative process. So when you so what happens is you're given the data if you join this contest. I wish I had a slide, but I don't. But the data might be to predict movie sales, or theater movie sales. So you'll have a data of that involves past movie sales, and you as a team work to try and come up with a model that makes predictions. You submit the predictions and a score is posted. You see the score and the whole community sees the score, and you get to iterate. So what happens is the teams keep iterating and trying to improve their score, and at the end of the competition, the winner produces something that's better than they would have done had they just worked alone. So it's this cooperative competition where people are competing against one another, but sharing the data and sharing their scores, and sometimes even sharing their methods and making those public as well. And the idea is that, that benefits the community as a whole. So I think this is kind of a radically different way of thinking about work and science. One of the questions I have for us all is how will this affect education? And should it, and what can we expect? So education. So as an educator, data science is still rather puzzling to me. And the reason I say that is for at least 20 years, the statistics community has said, let's stop teaching statistics as if it's math. Let's teach it based centered on data. Now, so for at least 20 years, we've been focusing the curriculum within statistics departments and some math departments on data analysis. But even so, I think it's true we've kind of erred on the side of of the inference culture. So I had the honor of participating this last summer in the Park City Math Institute undergraduate faculty program. And we were charged with coming up, we were charged with coming up with curriculum guidelines for an undergraduate data science program. And again, the motivation of this seemed to be that undergraduates need more data analysis than they're getting now. And in part because data plays such a huge role in the job market that we need to do a better job of preparing them. So the Park City Math Institute is a kind of unusual institution. It convenes every year on a different theme. This last year, the theme was the mathematics of data. And they have different groups. They have a research group and an undergraduate faculty group that I was a part of. And our chair was Dick DeVoe from Williams College. So for 3 weeks, we worked to come up with this this outline. There were only four or five statisticians, two computer scientists, and the rest were mathematicians. And it was predominantly liberal arts colleges, so not that many universities or larger public institutions represented, which I don't think you'll see in the details. But in any case, I just not going to talk about this too much except to bring your attention to what it is. It should be published soon in the Annual Review of Statistics and its applications. I'm not sure how many in the audience read that, but that's where it'll be. So basically, we identified six key areas that that undergraduates should be made aware of if they're going to call themselves data scientists or be prepared for that. The first area is huge, computational and statistical thinking. And I'm going to talk more about that when I talk about our high school program. Mathematical foundations is much smaller than you might think. And I'm not going to go through the whole thing, but model building includes both prediction and inference. And data curation is involved with this handout you've got. Where do data come from? How do we keep it? How do we store it? How do you give it to other people? How do you remember what the data are about, that sort of thing? And communication responsibility is another really interesting new area. This includes ethics. What are the ethics of data privacy? What are the ethics of data security? And also scientific reproducibility. How do I reproduce my analysis so that other people know where the data came from and how I changed the data to do the analysis and what I did? So I'm told there are now 250 undergraduate programs in data science around the country, and the number seems to be growing really rapidly. So they seem to come from a hodgepodge of different points of view, and we're hoping that this provides some sort of unity to how we think about undergraduate education in data science. So I'll spend the bulk of the rest of the time talking about two projects that are near and dear to my heart. The first is called Introduction to Data Science, and it's a high school class in data analysis and data science that's partnered with LAUSD. It has an unusual pedigree, which I'm going to tell you about, in part because it explains some of the eccentricities of the program, but also because it's interesting. I came into this project kind of in the middle, and so it was interesting to me to kind of see how large-scale educational projects involving data come together, because it's really a strange cast of characters in some ways. So the story begins with the Exploring Computer Science curriculum. This curriculum in itself is part of another larger project called Into the Loop, which is part of this big national data science and computing initiative from the Obama administration. So Exploring Computer Science is a high school computer science curriculum. They teamed up with the Center for Embedded Network Sensing at UCLA, which is another NSF research site led by Deborah Estrin. And they joined forces to create the Mobilize project, another NSF-funded project. So the goal of Mobilize was to use computational thinking and sensors, data from sensors, to enhance computer science and STEM education. Now, Mobilize then created a partnership between the statistics department, those two groups, the statistics department, Center X at UCLA, which is the teacher training department, and LAUSD. And LAUSD, I tried to make their insignia bigger, so it's the 800-pound gorilla in the room. As many of you know, a very large organization with many interesting policies. So the primary goal of Mobilize was to create these short 3 to 6 week modules. We created a 3 week mod or 5 week module for exploring computer science. We did a 3 week module for Algebra 1 and a 4 or 6 week module for biology. One of our early conclusions, not early enough unfortunately, was that there was just too much to do in 3 to 6 weeks, and if you do too much, it was like doing nothing at all. So we ended up creating this Introduction to Data Science curriculum. Along the way, Deborah Estrin at SENS left UCLA, and SENS left with her. So SENS no longer exists, and when she left, I came in. So that was kind of when the statistics department joined. And so this started out purely as a computer science initiative, but changed into a data science initiative involving a blend of computer science and statistics. So what is it? It's a year-long course. It requires Algebra 1. Students learn to program in R. This is still controversial, even amongst the team. We actually went through several iterations of different statistical software and programming languages and eventually settled on R. They use RStudio. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but RStudio is a friendlier interface to R. If you're not familiar with R, it's a command line programming language. No menus, you just sit there and you type. So you need to have a vocabulary, you need to know the syntax, otherwise you just stare at a blank screen. We created a package that the students work under called Mobilize R. It's based itself on another package called Mosaic, but basically it tries to unify the syntax of R. So if any of you are familiar with R, for any single action you may want to carry out, there's 3 or 4 or 5 different ways you could do it. So we tried to make sure everything could happen with just kind of one syntax. Everything meaning everything the students would need to do. R is itself an open source software, so it's free, big advantage for a large school district like LAUSD. But that accounts for some of its messiness. That's one reason why there's 4 or 5 different ways of doing everything, because if you have a new idea of a new way of doing something, it just gets added on. So it's a little unwieldy as a package. So the students work in computer labs to learn to apply the statistical concepts that they learn in the classroom and the rest of the time. I'm going to talk both about what I mean by statistical thinking and computational thinking. But what we see this course really is as a blend of those two ideas. It's a way of thinking about the world and a way about reasoning with data to understand the world better that uses both computation, meaning on a computer, and statistics. Okay, I'm going to skip that discussion. You may or may not be familiar with the guidelines for assessment of instruction in statistics education. I will guess not. But these come from the American Statistical Association. They have a K-12 set of guidelines, and the K-12 set of guidelines were used to fill out the statistics content in the Common Core curriculum. So in any case, this is technical if you're aware of that. So it's aligned with California Common Core standards, and it's now taught in about 30 LAUSD classrooms, and they plan to add a few classrooms every year. Partly because of its reliance on technology that limits how fast it can grow, because they're not quite ready for high level of technology in all classrooms yet, but they're working on it. So I mentioned we use computational thinking. What does that mean? The Computer Science Teachers Association has very complete standards for K-12. I could have filled pages after pages of slides with their standards, and I chose just a few of the standards that reflect the use of data. And many of these, as a statistician, I read and I think, that's just statistics. How dare you? Use data analysis to enhance understanding of complex natural and human systems. That's just statistics. Analyze data. That's just statistics. But the good news is it means we have a lot of common ground. So when we're doing statistics, we're also doing computer science. But it also shows that computer scientists and computer science teachers are really interested in having their students learning to make sense of data. So that's the common theme here. So we, you know, there's more about programming and doing this through a computer, and so we incorporate these as guidelines. When I talk about statistical thinking, what do I mean? So we introduced in this curriculum the notion of something we call the data cycle. It's essentially a modeling cycle. It's a way of thinking about problem solving. You begin with some sort of major research topic you want to know something about. Then you learn to ask questions. You then consider the data that you have available to help answer the questions. You might collect data to answer the questions. You analyze it. You make an interpretation that helps you answer the question. And then the cycle begins again. It's similar to, again, the Gay's recommendations and some other research done by Wild and Fancook. It's also really similar to the Common Core's mathematical modeling cycle. So it's really based on kind of a common simplified version of what it is we're doing when we're doing modeling. What's interesting about it in this context is most of the teachers, or actually all of the teachers in this curriculum, are math credentialed teachers. They've had a lot of experience as undergraduates with this. They've had a little bit of experience with this, almost no experience with this, and none whatsoever with that. So this whole notion of learning to ask questions strategically that can be answered with data is new to the mathematics curriculum. And it's turning out to be much more challenging than we thought. And that's probably going to surprise you if you came from a scientific or social science background where that's where your training was, asking really good questions. It's not necessarily part of mathematical training in the context of data analysis. So this whole curriculum was started by Mobilize, as I said, and Mobilize itself was centered around a notion called participatory sensing. And I want to say a little bit about that because it's kind of an exciting way of collecting data. As the picture suggests, and this is the 2-second version, it's using your phone to collect data. And that sounds kind of blasé, but there's more to it than that. It's really about using the phone to create a community that collects data together. And it's like citizen science, but in citizen science, we all go out and collect data, we send it to a scientist somewhere, and the scientist analyzes it. With this, the data stays within our group. So the notion is to build classroom communities where they collect data that they care about on their phones, and then the data stays within the classroom and they analyze that data for themselves. So that's kind of what the curriculum is based on. This is just a quick overview of one of the things they do. This was a participatory sensing campaign where every time they threw something away, they collected data about what they'd thrown away. And this is an interactive dashboard that helps them visualize that data. They can also download the data and then program and analyze it in R. But I just kind of, you know, these data end up being very rich. And they have lots of characteristics of big data. They, first of all, don't come from a random sampling paradigm. So all of statistical inference doesn't really apply. So it's not going to fit into that inference modeling culture. It contains data of many forms. There are pictures, there are GPS locations, there are time and date stamps, in addition to numbers and categories and just plain words. So it can allow you to collect some pretty rich data that doesn't fit into the traditional mathematical statistic classroom view of data analysis, and yet offers lots of opportunities for people to kind of, and students, to explore their world a little more deeply. Just a really quick overview of the topics that we cover in this curriculum. There are 4 units, each is about 10 weeks. I've listed some of the topics, but the ones in boldface are the ones I think are unusual for a statistics or any curriculum. Organizing data, how do you get it from written scribbles on a piece of paper into a software program. Learning to write simulations to estimate probabilities. Learning to merge data files, and why would you merge data files, and what problems does it solve. How to write a survey question that addresses a statistical question. So it's actually about collecting data, not just designing surveys, but writing the questions. And then doing predictions. How do you measure success of a prediction? So into the predictive modeling culture that Bryman talked about. So this LAUSD very boldly adopted this. I mean, I could say things that are disappointing about LAUSD, but they're really on the forefront of integrating computation into the high school curriculum, which I think they deserve kudos for. This curriculum is going to help them solve a couple of problems. So one problem, as Wayne and I were just talking about here, is if the Cal States do end up saying requiring 4 years of mathematics, there's a big challenge in the high schools about where all those 4 years of mathematics are going to come from. This would count as a year of mathematics. So this provides kind of an alternative pathway through the mathematics curriculum for students who wouldn't end up taking pre-calculus, for example. It also, in California, satisfies the A through G requirements. So it can satisfy the Algebra 2 requirement that Cal States and UCs have. So it also provides an alternative pathway around Algebra 2. As many, as some of you might know, there's a heated argument about the role of Algebra 2 in the curriculum. It tends to filter out students, and it tends to filter out different ethnic groups more than others, and different social economic groups more than others. So there's a lot of interest now in finding courses that are science oriented that are not Algebra 2. So this helps with that. All right. And now the final thing I want to talk to you is another event that we started at UCLA called Data Fest. And Wayne has been a big supporter of this from the very beginning, so I thank him for that. And I'll refer him to you if you have, refer you to him if you have questions after I leave. Data Fest is a celebration of data, as the name suggests. It's like a hackathon, but it's not quite a hackathon. The way it works is on Friday night, students arrive, they form their own teams, and the data are revealed to them Friday evening. They then have until Sunday to work. And what they work is they try to find insight in that data set. And during the weekend, there are statisticians, data scientists, and others from academics and industry roving the rooms and giving help when help is asked for, and sometimes when it's not. Which is something that they need. and I'm partly here asking for volunteers, so if this sounds interesting to you, I really urge you to come and visit us. Even if you don't know much statistics or something, if you're familiar with data analysis or you're familiar with science, you'll be a big help, because almost always what they need help with is not the technical matters, it's the strategizing about. I found that when they ask you a question, like, and the question is, I just can't get this routine to work, if you ask, why do you want that routine to work, that almost always solves the problem. Because the answer is almost always, oh, we don't really need this routine to work. So Sunday afternoon, they have just 5 minutes to present to judges. So it's like a rapid fire presentation to a panel of judges, and then the judges choose the winners. The prizes, are meant to kind of guide them in certain directions. There's a prize for best insight, very vaguely defined, and that leaves it up to them to say, what do we think is the most interesting thing we can say about these data that address the general issues that were presented to us? And I'll say more about that in a second. Then there's best visualization, which is just what it sounds like, a nice picture that illustrates some insights into the data. And best use of external data encourages them to find another data set that enhances the context of the data set that they're working with and leads to some deeper knowledge. So here are our past contests. The very first one was the Los Angeles Police Department in 2011. So they said to the group, we want you to make a policy recommendation based on data that would reduce crime. And the data they gave was a record of every arrest for the last 10 years, I think. There were over 10 million, sadly enough. It had about 200 variables. The most recent one was Ticketmaster. They had data from visits to their web pages, and they wanted to know, you know, are there patterns of behaviors that would identify fans of certain groups or scalpers? You know, so can you kind of classify and help us determine who is coming to the website in a way that we can use to improve the experience. So choosing the data is really hard. We look for not really big data, but pretty big, 1 to 2 gigabytes, in an interesting context. We spend about half of a year working with the company so that it satisfies their legal concerns. And we're looking for something that has a personality, a story that students would find interesting. DataFest has grown. We started at UCLA, like I said, in 2011. It's now held at about 30 sites around the country, including 2 in Canada and 1 in Germany, and maybe 1 in Australia. It's hosted by now the American Statistical Association. So they help kind of run it as a national competition. So if you go to that website up there, or you talk to Wayne, or you talk to me, we'd be happy to kind of point you out to how you might want to get involved. This is not quite the secret sauce that David Donahoe talked about, but it comes pretty close. It's a cooperative competition. So the students are working in teams with a common goal of analyzing this data set. There is a referee, a panel of judges who will decide who wins the prize. And because of the way the roving visitors work and because of the fact everyone is working in the same room, ideas are shared and slipped out. And as a result, the products that the students come up with are all much better than they would have done if they'd been working by themselves and not in that environment. And the products actually shock me. Some of the students, you know, not all of them, but many of them are students I've seen in class. I think like, really? You can do that? We struggled so hard for just basic things, and now look what you've done. It's really kind of amazing what happens if it's not associated with the grade. And I mean that quite literally. And I'll just tell you one anecdote, because it illustrates what I mean by that external data sort of thing. One team a couple of years ago consisted of students who I'll just say were maybe B plus students. Not bad students, not good students. I had them in one class, and I don't know how good or bad they were in other classes. But the data came from a national group, GridPoint, that puts sensors in retailers' locations to measure their energy consumption. And so the challenge here was to analyze this data to create some sort of way that would help GridPoint communicate to its customers how they were using energy. And to do that, they had to give us the weather data, because it doesn't make sense to compare energy consumption if you don't know what the weather is in a place. But they couldn't really give us the weather data exactly because, they didn't want to give us the locations of these places because they didn't want to spoil their client privileges. So they just told us the zip code that the retailers, no, it was the county that the retailers were in. But they also gave us the weather data for the location. And this team, who, like I said, always struck me as pretty ordinary students, they created a web crawler that went out and it matched the weather data to particular locations and predicted where the actual locations of these businesses were. And not only did it predict, but it gave uncertainty estimates for it. So it was this kind of, it really kind of blew the judges away that they could do this in 48 hours. So they really kind of rise to the occasion and do things that we didn't expect. So I think this is one of the summaries I guess I get out of this is as we're thinking about using open data and as we're thinking about these open environments for working, and by the way, I see the whole open data initiative and the whole open whatever initiative mainly one about how are we going to work together and not so much about how our product's going to be distributed. How can we use this sort of framework to teach and students to learn? If you're not familiar with Kaggle, it's a website that lets you run competitions and you can set it up for a classroom. So I do this with, teach a course in predictive modeling, and the final grade is given, the team that scores the highest gets the best grade and so on down. And again, it's pretty astounding because they all do much, much better than they would ever do without this. DataFest, like I said, partially fits into this model, but it's an extracurricular thing. It happens once a year. It's not every day. If you're not familiar, there's a literature now on something called model eliciting activities. These are basically used in science and engineering classes. It came out of the engineering education literature. And it's a way of creating activities that force force is a strong word, encourage students to engage in the modeling process. And it has many of these common task frameworks in point where there's an iterative process built in that forces students themselves to evaluate their work and improve. So I leave this as an open question, you know, to all of you. How are we going to make, it's not enough, I mean, open data is great, but it's not enough just to bring the data. We have to build a pedagogy around this. We have to build curricula around this. And it looks like there are certain directions the community is already moving. And I think our challenge now is how do we learn from the motion that's already happening to work with the data that we're going to be giving them. So again, I thank you for inviting me, and I'd like to hear your comments if you can send them.
Yes, thank you very much. We allocated time for questions for Rob, and we want to use the mic. Is that right, Tony?
Yes.
To be on, okay. All right. Questions for Rob. We have a few minutes for questions, and we'll take a break and convene again.
My name is Jerry Schutte. I'm a statewide academic senator for the CSU. And my question has to do with that, which is why I announced it. About 3 weeks ago, the statewide Senate, at the end of a long task force this summer on quantitative reasoning, passed a resolution recommending a fourth year of quantitative reasoning, with quotes, to the LACSUSD. I listened with interest about your work with the LAUSD, and my question is this. If that were to be taken literally, what proportion of kids do you think would opt for an Algebra 2 versus the kind of class you're talking about?
Yeah, that's an excellent question that I wish I had some data for. what we're seeing so far is a lot of students doing both. And in part, that's because LAUSD is trying to create the notion, and rightly so, I think, of computer science as another trajectory that doesn't supersede the math trajectory, but maybe complements it, even though this fourth year requirement would mean that you could, it could be an alternative to it. So partly because school counselors aren't yet fully aware of this, and they're not fully aware of the alternatives, the choices that students already have, it's not quite clear that the message is getting through that they don't have to take Algebra 2 yet. So I think a fairly significant portion will choose not to take Algebra 2 someday, but right now I don't know how big it'll be. You should just throw it.
Hi, Regan Moss from the Department of Geography. And so you might know what my question might be. Wondering if in your curriculum there's been any talk or conversation about adding in the idea of space, especially when you're developing, sort of thinking about those questions and exploring the data. I don't know if that's ever been a part of the conversation.
So I'm not sure we would have phrased it just like that, but I think one place the curriculum falls short is we didn't have an expert on mapping and understanding maps. And maps turn out, as you know, but we were surprised. Maps turn out to be highly charged objects that provoke heated discussion that is much more heated than your typical Algebra 2 discussion. And so we have worked with people about helping teachers to moderate those discussions, but we could definitely benefit from the influence of experts in geography who know how to go about creating and discussing maps more scientifically.
Hi, Ravi Abrol from Chemistry and Biochemistry here. For the one-year course that you have in LAUSD, are the math teachers trained for this?
Yeah.
And how it works?
Yeah, so the math teachers go through a summer institute that's 4 days at the beginning of the summer and 3 days at the end of the summer, and then one Saturday a month for 6 months during the school year as support. So that's more intensive than LAUSD usually gives, and the state in California in general is cutting way back on professional development. So that's a serious hindrance to any sort of educational reform right now. And so that means that the emphasis really has to be on the pre-service teachers and making sure that they're learning this material earlier than ordinarily would happen.
There was another question there, Elizabeth.
Hi, my name is Mark Rasai, and I've been hired at this institution a year ago as a so-called digital humanist. So, like, if I would like to ask a question on the big picture, meaning, I thank you so much for offering, like, I mean, this overview about the differences between statistics and data sciences as a reaction, so-called, yeah. Like, I mean, statistics. Of course, I see within, let's say, my broad range of disciplines in the humanities, a renewed interest in statistics. Because of course, when quantitative analysis or data mining become possible in literature and other fields, we want to learn. but on the other hand, the humanities usually bring with them this sort of metacognitive reflection on what we're doing, questioning our methodologies. I know, for example, some digital humanists such as Joanna Drucker, they even talk about the fact that a set of data independent of interpretation cannot exist. So maybe we should maybe even reconfigure the concept of data as such. She talks about CAPTA or something. That's more subjective. I was just wondering, if you see, how do you see, this negotiation coming from the humanities? Because when you talk about computational and statistic, mathematical thinking, you're talking about STEM disciplines. So what is your experience of these negotiations with the humanities? And if it impacts or influences the shaping of the curriculum you were talking about? Thank you.
Yeah, it's a big question. I have a short answer, I guess, but I could talk longer. But so I talked about data science, but I shied away from defining data. And defining data it is harder than it used to be. There's a well-known definition in stats called where data are numbers in context, and that's very obsolete. I have a colleague who says the word data is really meant as a metaphor for anything that could conceivably be digitized and analyzed. So I guess what I hear from your question, though, is the need for how do we bring this wider definition of data into education and when do we bring it in? And I think the key to that is really to have people like yourselves, because this is the difficulty, is framing the questions that the data could answer. Because it's not enough, again, to say, and this is the trouble we had with our project, giving the teachers, here's the data, have fun, without really strong scientific is too strong or too narrow a word, but very strong research-oriented questions, the data are just empty to the students. So that's I think, where we really need help.
Maybe one more question, and then we'll take a break.
So isn't this just another way of saying that the research is not hypothesis-driven?
Yes. Well, should not be hypothesis driven, maybe.
When I was in my research program, exploratory research, where you just look for the relationships and the outcomes without a hypothesis, but created your hypothesis or your explanation upon seeing what the associations were, the regression weights, et cetera, that was a no-no.
Yeah. Well, and I think it should raise red flags. So I'll just share one quick thing. Like, one thing we've been studying is how do people begin to attack a problem? And students or teachers who look at these data sets and just start throwing up graphics and looking for solutions end up not going anywhere. And
students or teachers who look at the data and say, what is an what questions do I have about these data? So they are forming hypotheses, and the hypotheses are exploring are guiding the exploration. They do much better. So those seven pillars. I mean, that's partly what that eighth pillar needs to be for, is to help us understand how to carry out those investigations in a rigorous way.
Please join me in giving Rob one more hand.
Thank you very much.